All right, good morning and welcome to Compass. Great to have you. Thank you for being here this morning, starting your week off with us. I'll just say this up front, I am fighting a head cold and a really sore throat, so I'm going to try not to bring anything up that's going to gross you out or me, but I'll do my best to get through this. It was way worse Thursday night, so you guys did good coming on Sunday. Hey, I don't think that Lizzie and Chris mentioned, but we will be doing a trip to Uganda this summer, and I would love for some of you to sign up and go on that trip for the first time. It's a really amazing trip, and we would love to have you join and be part of that and going and serving on the mission field there as well. We just saw, we're kicking off our series Stranger Things next week, looking at some of the unseen things, the paranormal, spiritual world. But today, we're finishing up our series on letters from my future self. And let me start with this. So how many of you know what this image is here? A few of you? Some of you? If you're under 30, right, like you've grown up with a laptop and a keyboard, you have no idea what that is. That's how we used to create documents whenever we rode dinosaurs to work and didn't have shoes and stuff like that. That's what we would use. I took a basic typewriting class whenever I was a freshman in high school, which has been a long time ago. We also had this stuff called whiteout. Remember whiteout? For whenever you would make mistakes. Right, it's like the little bottle of white ink, and it had a brush in there, and you would take that brush and you would white out your misspelled words and your typos. Then they came along, do you remember the white out strips, like on the little tape dispenser, the strips, which I used a lot of that because I'm terrible at typing. Like my favorite button on my phone or on a laptop is the backspace or delete button because I hit the wrong key always. So I'm glad we have computers so I don't have to grab the white out every time I mess up. Do you know what I did like about typewriters? Here's the thing I did like. You could not lose an unsaved document, right? Because how many of you've been working on your computer, working on a paper, working on a document, creating some spreadsheet or file, and you failed to save it, and then the computer glitched or crashed or something went wrong, and you lost everything, right? And you have to start completely over from scratch, which how unbelievably frustrating and annoying is that to make all of this progress, and then you have to start all over from the beginning. Well, today we're closing out our series, Letters from My Future Self. We've been talking about if we had this ability to like write a note to our current self from our future self to encourage or to remind or to plead with ourselves on some things, what would we say and what would we write? Because here's what we inherently know. The decisions you and I make right now that we make today shape our future and they shape who we are becoming. So we want to make sure and get some things right. And so on our final day, here's kind of our final thought we're going to go with. And that's this. Start over, right? This is the word that some of you need to hear today in the final letter. Start over, right? And we'll unpack that here in a second. Let me read from Proverbs chapter 9. Here's what we read there in verse 6. Leave your simple ways behind and listen and begin to live, right? Not exist, not just hang in there. Begin to live. Learn to use good judgment. So let me say this. Some of you, right, you're in a season right now where you feel like you put so much work into something and you made so much effort in the relationship or in the job or some other thing, and then you feel like it just got deleted, right? Like the whole thing got erased. And now you're having to start over from scratch and you're not sure you have the energy or the ability or maybe even the desire to try again. So maybe it's a long-term relationship that came to a really painful end and now you're back at square one. Or maybe it's an investment or some business that you started and it didn't make it and now you're trying to figure out what's next. Maybe some addiction or some habit took control of you and you lost the spouse or you lost the opportunity, you lost the job. And now you're trying to figure out, you feel like a failure and trying to figure out how to get a clean start and to begin again. Maybe just the kids have all moved out or the company's downsized and you're not where you used to be. So here's what I think. When it comes to starting over, I think there are some fears that try to put us on lockdown and paralyze us to keep us from taking a step towards starting over or towards a new opportunity or new purpose. And here's some things that I think we tend to fear. We fear this, that we would be hurt again, right? I trusted them. I gave my heart to them. I believed in them, and they burned me, or they betrayed me. They abused me. My heart, it is hurt and it is wounded, and no way, no way I'd try that again. Or maybe your fear is this, that you would fail again, that I tried and I gave it my best. I risked everything, and it was a train wreck, right? Just complete and total failure. I couldn't do it. No one would want me. I'm not good enough. I don't have what it takes. There's no point in even trying again. And then the third thing I think that we fear is that we would just disappoint again. I let them down. I messed up really bad. I did some really horrible things. I don't want to be another disappointment to someone, and God probably doesn't want me or even want to use me anyway. So I think we all hear these voices of doubt and of accusation. I read an article on Starting Over, and it talked about how we will all be faced with moments and with people that will remind us of our failure or of our pain. But then it goes on, and it said this in the article, I wrote this down. It said, it doesn't matter if the situation was beyond your control, if it was just random or directly your fault. Listen, it's the right time to move forward and not stay where you are now. And then it said, because this type of negativity harms you and keeps you from living fully, which again, Proverbs 9 said, begin to live. Paul writes this in 2 Corinthians 5. Anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old is gone, a new life, right? A new life has begun. And not only does God want to make you a new person in Christ, but he continues to renew us and to give us new purpose and use us in new ways. So here's what I want us to do. I want to look at a few examples, right? Not just one story. I'm going to give you a few different people and try to give you some words to encourage you, right? Because maybe you're feeling stuck. Again, maybe you're feeling like it's too hard. Because there's some challenges, right? Too hard, I'm stuck, there's just no opportunity, right? The variables are working against me. So let me give you a few thoughts to help you take that next step if you are feeling down or discouraged or a little bit hopeless and helpless. And let me start with this thought for some of you in the room. And first let me ask, audience participation, how many of you born and raised in Texas, right? Native Texas. Okay, so quite a few in the room, so I'm assuming if your hand's not up, you're a transplant, right? From the South, from the Northeast, maybe from the West, you didn't grow up in Texas. So I've been here for about 5 years now, and I've learned a few things, like I've learned, and I would say this is true in the South, I've learned there are certain things that you don't talk about unless you want to draw a line in the sand and pick a fight, right? Or you're going to get in trouble. Like you don't talk about someone's mother, right? Like, where were you last night? I was at your mom's. Right? Like that's going to, you're going to get in a fight. You don't talk about someone's dog, right? You don't mess with people's dogs here. You don't talk about their mom's dog, right? You don't mess with either one. Their truck, right? Just like those are things that are just off limits. You don't talk about NFL teams that are not the Dallas Cowboys, right? And God's clearly chosen team, unless you want to end up on the naughty list and have your house vandalized, right? By Cowboys gear, right? That's what you'll get. So knowing that, five years here now, with that in mind, I would like to talk about the Patriots. Hey, listen, hey, don't write me off and don't ignore me now because I'm not a Patriots fan, just so you know. I don't not like the Patriots. I don't have animosity towards them. I'm just a Christian, right? And I feel like that Jesus calls us to be generous and spread the wealth. And I feel like they've been a little stingy with Super Bowl rings, and I don't need to see another ring on Tom Brady's finger. So I'm not pulling for the Patriots either. But listen, Super Bowl 2017 was unreal. I mean, it just was, if you're into sports at all. And I'm more of a casual football watcher, just so you know, especially if it's teams I don't care about, right? Patriots and Atlanta. But I am watching the game. Patriots are down 28-9 going into the fourth quarter. A couple minutes left in the third quarter, they're down 28-3, right? So they're not scoring, they're behind. I'm just hanging out at that point to watch commercials because it looks like the game is over. And then like they staged the greatest comeback in Super Bowl history. They've got to score two touchdowns. Remember this if you watch the game. Two touchdowns plus 2-point conversions on both of those with time running out. 59 minutes and 3 seconds of that game, they are losing the game, right? They're behind that entire time. And with less than a minute left on the clock, they finally tie the game up. And like you could just feel that the momentum had shifted, and like all the odds that were working against them were now all of a sudden working in their favor. Like for some reason, the football gods were back on their side. And you just felt, right, that there was no stopping their roll. And they did. They come back and they win that game in overtime. And here's all that I want to say about that, because I don't want to keep talking about the Patriots. But here's what I do want to say. And for someone in the room, the Patriots were seriously behind, but there was still time on the clock, right? And if there's still time on the clock, the game's not over. And maybe you're here today, and maybe you're that person, and you feel like you know, the enemy has just been running the score up on you lately. And you feel like you're getting behind in this game of life, and you feel like the enemy's scoring more points on you than you are on him, and maybe feeling stuck or defeated or discouraged. And God's word for you and for us today is, listen, there's still time on the clock. And I would just want you to hear, if you're not dead, God's not done. He still has plans for you. He still has future. He still has hope for you. And I hope someone today have the courage to start over, right? And to take that step towards new opportunity, new season, new potential. So I want to give you a few roadblocks that I want you to work through that I think may keep us from moving to that new season, some obstacles that get in the way. Here's the first one, so some issue that may be holding you back, and that's this. It hurt too much, right? That is the roadblock for some of you. It hurt too much. And listen, I get it. And I'll talk about this one more time. I've kind of hit on this theme throughout this series. I'm going to let it go after this series. But I've shared that my family, we served at a church where we just got beat down and just wounded deeply. And it would have been easy to let that hurt keep me from trying again or being faithful to pursue God's call and God's purpose for our life. To be like, nope, that it hurt too much. I'm out. It's just not worth it. To listen, to become critical and to become cynical and to focus on all the things that are wrong rather than still believing what God could do. And again, I get it, man. Like it's way easier to put the wall up and refuse to risk or to try again so you don't have to walk through that pain again so that that person would never wound you in that way again. I know, right? I hear you. But I would just rather risk and trust people than get stuck and lose hope. Right? I don't want to waste time and miss out on what God can do because I'm stuck in fear or bitterness, which made me think about Nehemiah. So in week 3, we discussed Nehemiah and we talked about dream big. Right? We want you to dream big dreams. And he had this great dream because he'd grown up in slavery. Jerusalem, where his ancestors were from, had been destroyed. And he's got this dream to go back and rebuild the city and rebuild the wall and restore it. And he goes to the king, right? A king that doesn't even believe in his God. And he makes a crazy ask. And he gets the king's blessing and his favor. And it sounds great in chapter 1 and 2. But if you go on in the story, he gets back to Jerusalem to start rebuilding the wall. And a group of people come that are from there and should be for him. And they start to attack and they start to undermine his work, and then just constantly trying to discourage him and to turn the people against him. And what does Nehemiah do? Well, he stays focused on the mission, and he ignores them, and he prays, continues to pray, and hands it to God. And then what happens? They keep criticizing, and they keep coming at him, and they keep stirring the people to complain and come against him. So it's just one hit, and one shot, and one challenge after another. And then I want you to see what Nehemiah says in chapter 4, his words as he's facing some of this conflict and just these shots. He says this, "Then as I looked over the situation," right? Kind of these people that are fighting against him and making this hard and making life difficult. "I called the nobles and the rest of the people and said to them, 'Don't be afraid of the enemy. Remember the Lord who is great and glorious and fight. Fight for your brothers, fight for your sons, for your daughters, your wives, and your homes.' To which I would say, Here's what I would love, and I would love for you. I would like for things to come easy, right? For all my relationships or work opportunities or things that I want to pursue to always go great. But here's the reality. Reality is there's oftentimes resistance, right? And there's oftentimes these challenges that we have to overcome. And I just want you to hear, like Nehemiah found, we don't make progress without pressing forward into some of the pain. Right, I heard a guy say this comment about this section, that there is no progress without pain. So Nehemiah is asking the people in this moment, are you gonna quit? Are you gonna tap out? Will the pain be too much for us? Will the risk be too high? Are you done or will you fight? And I would say this, if you want something better, more, different for your family, for your future, for your finances, kids, sometimes that comes with pain. You'll have to fight, you'll have to persevere, you'll have to sacrifice. Oftentimes, life is about playing hurt. And I'm not saying if you've been wounded deeply, you don't go and get counseling and you don't go and get help. But sometimes I watch like espionage or political thrillers and you've got this terrorist or this threat, this bad force that they're trying to stop. And on the journey, or even watch some action movies, the hero, the heroine often end up in scuffles and banged up and bruised and beat up as they pursue. And sometimes as you're pursuing a great calling, it is about playing hurt. But there's no progress sometimes without pain. And I would encourage you, some of you, don't give up and don't quit. Next thing that often gets in the way, second obstacle, we think this. We think it's too late, right? I'm too old. I've already had one failed marriage or two or five, right? It's too late for me to find happiness. I'm middle-aged or I'm older. It's too late for me to pursue and achieve those things that I really want to do, to chase my dream, to hope for something more. And we feel like that we're finished. So there's no point in really trying or going out or starting over. And I just want to say that sometimes we forget how big and powerful and good and mighty our God is, and how God doesn't operate on our timeline or other people's expectations. Do you know that? Like, God doesn't work that way. And we've got this good, big, mighty God and dad. And I think we forget that. So, and I was thinking about this because a few weeks ago, my wife, Molly, and our oldest daughter, they were flying back into town from being gone. They were flying into DFW late one evening. I'm at home, it's Sunday night. I'm at home with our other kids and they're already in bed and they're asleep. So I'm staying with them and Molly and our daughter, they're gonna Uber home. So she's trying to get an Uber and she's having a problem with her app where she can't get it scheduled and pay to come pick her up. So we're on the phone, she's working through this, trying to figure it out, and we're talking as she's walking around in the airport trying to get that done. And finally she's able to get it to work and schedule an Uber. Well, the next day we're sitting at the table and we're talking and she's sharing the story and things I didn't know that night. But she told me that she was a little bit startled because a man walked up to her at the airport late that night. And she said it caught her off guard a little bit. He was polite, but it was really late. And it startled her some because he walked up and said, "I've noticed you walking around for some time now. And I just needed to tell you, you're beautiful." Right, which I absolutely agree with, and that's true. But I don't know if like he's got the gift of encouraging words, if he's picking up on her, right? What's going on there? But it's late, and so she's telling me this story with our 11-year-old son, Zeke, at the table as well. And so she says, you know, it just caught me a little bit off guard because, you know, it's kind of weird. I noticed you walking, and she said, I wasn't sure what to do with that. And so then Zeke, my 11-year-old, he's like, "Well, it's a good thing that dad wasn't there, right? Because he's my kid, right? And he thinks dad's awesome." Like all little kids do, they think dad has an S on their chest and they have a cape underneath their work clothing. So he says that. And then my wife responds and she's like, "Well, he kind of looked like and was about the size of Josh, Josh Akers, which is our youth pastor, right?" And so I'm doing this on Thursday night and I'm like, you know, Josh is like 6'3", 6'4", and he's sitting right there. He's like, "Actually, I'm 6'1", bro." So I tried to exaggerate and it didn't work, but Josh is like 6'1", bald, big, huge goatee, and he's just yoked, right? He's just a big, stocky dude. So Molly says that, and then Zeke processes that, and he's like, "Oh." And I'm like, I'm like, "What do you mean, oh," right? Like, Like, don't be saying, oh. Like, I know that he can crush me, right? But you're my kid, and you're supposed to believe that dad can do anything, right? Like I can't because I'm limited, but you're supposed to think that I can. But listen, here's the thing. God's not limited, right? He's not like me. He doesn't have restrictions. And I think sometimes we stop believing in all that our Heavenly Father can and wants to do in our lives way too soon. And it made me think about Caleb in the Old Testament, right? Caleb, who was one of two guys who trusted God and believed God whenever they come out of slavery in Egypt and the people are heading to the promised land, believes God could do big things and is capable of a mighty work but because everyone else complains and they grumble and they doubt God, but then they end up doing this circle in the desert, like the cul-de-sac of the desert for 40 years, just stuck on the treadmill before God finally sends them into the promised land. But then listen to what Caleb says in Joshua when he does finally get to enter into the promised land in this new season. He says this, Joshua 14, verse 7. It says, I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to explore the land of Canaan. I returned and gave an honest report, but my brothers who went with me frightened the people from entering the promised land. For my part, I wholeheartedly followed the Lord my God. Now, as you can see, the Lord has kept me alive and well, as he promised, for all these 45 years since Moses made his promise, even while Israel wandered in the wilderness. Today, I am 85 years old. I am as strong now as I was when Moses sent me on that journey, and I can still travel and fight as well as I could then. And then in verse 13, so Joshua blessed Caleb, son of Jephunneh, and gave Hebron to him as his portion of the land. To which I would ask, so what is Caleb saying? He's saying, I'm not finished yet, right? And how old is he? He's 85. It has been 45 years since they first got this peek at the promised land. And he's like, now you want me to start? Now you want me to go and take this thing? That's not what he's saying, right? He said, I followed God wholeheartedly all these years ago, and I am still trusting him right now, and I feel good, and I feel hopeful, so let's go and do this thing. And some of you in the room, you need to decide you're not finished just because everyone else is or because someone else thinks that you are. It's not too late. I think we have to decide in our own hearts that you're not gonna let anything or anyone else decide when you are done, because you have a great dad, right? A great father that has great plans for you. Do you know what I think is the saddest part of this story is you've got all these other thousands of Jewish people that they don't go into the promised land and they don't get this new start and a chance at this new opportunity because they quit too soon. I don't think God can do this. I don't trust him. Let's go back to Egypt. Let's go back to slavery. Their failure wasn't that they failed. Their failure was they quit too soon. I think that God is looking for people like Caleb going, I'm not finished yet, and I will look, and I will wait for the opportunity, and I will start whenever it comes. So that's the second prayer that I've got for several of you this morning, that you would be like Caleb, right? Where God is gonna give you a new career or a new opportunity or a new relationship in your life at the most ridiculous moment or stage of your life. And you will be hungry and ready to run whenever that comes, right? It's not too late. Then the final thing for a few of you in the room, the last hurdle, obstacle that gets in our way from starting over. Here's what you think. I messed up too bad, right? It was too deep, too heavy. I'm a huge disappointment. No way I can move forward and start over now. Do you know who else thought that in the Bible? Peter, right? Peter, who is Jesus' right-hand guy. Peter, who will go on to be one of the greatest leaders for the church. And you know why I know that he thought that? Because after he denies Jesus and after he turns his back and lets Jesus down in his moment of greatest need, then what does Peter do? He goes back to his old trade, right? Back to his old occupation, back to the fishing docks, basically going, I blew it. I might as well just move on, right? It's too late. Go back to my old lifestyle. Go back to my old way of living because I've failed. And I guarantee you, I promise you that he heard all the voices of doubt, that he's worthless, he's a disappointment. But here's the interesting thing to me. Jesus knew this was coming. And he had already let him know that he still believes in him and that he's got plans for him, right? Because listen to what Jesus tells us in Luke chapter 22, verse 31. He says, Simon, which is Peter, Simon, Simon, Satan has asked, so this is pre-Peter denying, Satan has asked to sift each of you like wheat, but I have pleaded in prayer for you, Simon, that your faith should not fail. So that, watch, when you have repented, why is he gonna have to repent? Because he's gonna screw up, right? Jesus knows. So when you have repented and turned to me again, then strengthen your brothers. So again, what's he saying? Yes, you're gonna blow it big time, right? You're totally gonna screw up, but I'm praying for you, right? I've pleaded for you and I believe in you and I have plans for you. So listen, don't let your faith fail, because when you repent and turn back and trust me, you're gonna get a new start and you're gonna strengthen the brothers and lead the church. And so Jesus knew that he was gonna hear all the voices and the accusations that we hear whenever we blow it. Right? Some of you, maybe in your heart, in your life, you're really hearing this stuff right now, just on repeat and replay in your head. I think we all wrestle with this at certain times or certain levels. At least I do, if I'm transparent. So I want us to look real quick at some words in Zechariah that I hope are encouraging to you. And I want to encourage you with these, because maybe you're feeling down or discouraged, like there's not hope for you. And listen to what this little interaction that goes on in Zechariah 3 says this. Then the angel showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord. The accuser, right? There he is. You talk about accusation. Here's the accuser. The accuser, Satan, was there at the angel's right hand, doing what? Making accusations against Joshua. So we know this about Satan. Satan is a liar, right? Jesus tells us, John chapter 8, his native language, lying. This is what he does. He's a liar and he's an accuser. And some of you are hearing this. Whether you're in a really great season, I hope you're in a good season, or if you're in a really dark season, Satan is constantly looking for ways to accuse you and derail you, right? That's his goal. I'm gonna accuse you, lie to you, derail you. So which is a great reminder that all of us, everybody in here needs the grace of God, right? And so that we're completely clear, because maybe you're in a bad season, but even on our best day, we need the grace of God. Meaning, if you get up in the morning at 4:30 a.m. to spend an hour and a half in prayer and studying your Bible, right? Where Jesus shows up and pours you coffee so you can keep going, right? And then when you get done, you go into the kitchen and you find out that your spouse or your roommate left the sink full of dirty dishes and you think, praise Jesus, right? Because this is a serve opportunity. I needed a chance to serve, here it is. And so you clean the dishes, you do them, you make it all nice, clear out the sink, then you jump in your car, you're a little late, so the commute to work is really heavy, and some jerk cuts you off and jams you up and gives you the international sign for your number one and says some really choice words, and you think, thank you, God, right? Thank you, God, because blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. And I'm feeling very blessed right now. So thank you, God, for doing that. And then you get to your office, right? And all your unbelieving coworkers are like, what is it that is so different about you? And you explain to them, you have been in the presence of God and he's just like blessing you abundantly. And so they wanna know more. And you lead all of them to Jesus and you take them out and baptize them in the fountain in front of your office and they're all saved. And then later that night, because it's been such a great day, you're just walking and meditating on what a fantastic day in life it's been, and you're just caught up in your meditation and you look down and you are walking on water because you're that spiritual and holy, right? Okay. In that moment, on that day, we still fall short, right? And we need God's grace. And listen, Satan will find something, just like here with the high priest. He will find something to accuse you of. And maybe you're hearing it, right? Again, he's accusing the high priest. And I would say this, Satan doesn't tend to have to accuse me of things that I didn't do, right? You know what I'm talking about? Like we've all given him some stuff to work with, okay? You're jacked up too, right? We've done that. But maybe you're really hearing those voices, right? They're just beating you down. The accusations are heavy. They're weighing on your soul. But I want you to look at what Zechariah records God saying next in verse 2. And the Lord said to Satan, I, the Lord, reject your accusation, Satan. Yes, the Lord has chosen Jerusalem, who has chosen Jerusalem, rebukes you. This man is like a burning stick. Okay, so that's bad. That has been what though? Snatched from the fire. And I thought about that imagery. Have you ever been in a fight? Some of you, you've been in a fight? Have you ever lost a fight? If you put your hand down, you're a liar, right? We've all been in fight and lost. Do you not always love like the hyper-spiritual person that comes up and is like, there's no winners in a fight? I'm like, okay, like I get that. But I've been on the giving end and receiving end. And I agree with Jesus. It's better to give than to receive. That is true. That's totally poor use of that verse. But maybe you remember from childhood, had someone bigger than you come and pick on you and try to bully you and say hurtful things and take advantage. And then someone bigger than them comes along and puts them in their place. This is the imagery, right? God is fighting for you, and you need to know he rejects the accusations that Satan is making against you. So don't ever use that as an obstacle to not start over or try again or believe that your dad has good things for you. Because what did he say? He said, this man is like a burning stick that's been snatched from the fire. Right? That's like cross imagery. I know he was a mess, but I've snatched him out of that. In other words, I knew what he would do before I created him, and I created him anyway. And by the way, I went ahead and arranged for payment to be made on his behalf for everything you're right now accusing him of, right? That's snatching him from the fire. So your heavenly father shuts down the accusations Satan's trying to make against you, right? He doesn't let the enemy mess with his kids. Because reality is, before we were ever created, before you're created, I'm created, he knew. He knew about the addiction. He knew about the affair. He knew about the abortion. He knew about the screw up. He knew about the stupid, foolish, sinful things that we would do. And he created us, and he loved us, and he arranged payment to be made on our behalf so that you could get a fresh start and live out a great story. And here's where I want us to do today as we wrap out this series. Maybe you're in that season. We're gonna sing this song, Come to the Altar. Because listen, the Father's arms are open wide. If you're hurting really bad, if you feel like I'm past my pull date, right? Like I'm expiration date, it's too late, or I just feel like a big disappointment, Father's arms are open wide. And I would encourage you to make that decision today. I'm starting over, right? I'm drawing the line in the sand. I'm not saying stuck, I'm stepping into a new season. Next week, we're going to do baptisms. I mean, you can get baptized today, but next week we're gonna have a baptism Sunday. I would encourage some of you to come and grab this towel. If you've never given your life to Christ, you'd like to say, I wanna start with the guy that makes me into a new person and go from there. Or you've just had a season where you've wandered, you've let the hurt consume you, and you're like, I'm not gonna have that anymore. I'm going to mark today or next week as a new moment, a new opportunity, a new high for my life, and you would just grab a towel. So I would encourage you, we're gonna have some people, if you want to, grab a towel, then head over here to your right. Sam will be over here. We've got some stuff where we can sign and get your information. But I want you to do that if God would call you to do that today. So let me pray, and we're gonna sing. In fact, why don't you guys stand up. Make it easier to move, then we'll pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you're this really great God that loves his kids, that understands the hurt, and he steps into the hurt to help us find healing and move forward, that believes in us at all seasons of our life, early, middle, young, late. You're still creating new opportunities, and that just isn't disappointed. You knew and you still wanted us. So I pray today would be a moment for someone in the room, for several people, that we say, I start over today and I trust you with this thing. God, we love you. We pray these things in your son's precious and holy name.